The following program contains graphic material, including offensive language. Viewer discretion is advised.
These are the sounds of crushed souls. The sounds of despair from former radio personalities, languishing in the purgatory of corporate consolidation. These former radio personalities have lost their livelihoods, not because they weren't entertaining or informative, but because they don't meet today's corporate terrestrial broadcast standards of being smelly, overweight douchebags, seething with vein-popping hatred. These radio refugees and their audiences have since migrated to the internet, but their struggle continues as the quest for monetization ensues. Nicole Sandler is leading the way to reestablishing thought-provoking and entertaining radio. And you can help by clicking the donate button on NicoleSandler.com. Donate today, or as much and as often as you can. Dry the tears of listeners by removing the rotting stench of corporate radio. Won't you help?
All right. Apparently, we're having audio problems, so hold on. Severe breaking up, and I see why. I'm just going to do a radio show today. So here's the deal. First of all, I apologize for being off the air all last week. Today happens to be 1 year since we moved, since we arrived in Arizona. It was 1 year ago today. We arrived in Arizona. The picture showed up on my memories on Facebook. And, it said entering Arizona 1 year ago today. When we got here, we had an Airbnb reserved for like 10 days. And can somebody fill in the newcomers into the chat room about what's happening? Because Wayne just said my audio is choppy. Wayne, I'm really sorry. You have to listen to one of the audio apps. Okay? One, either progressivevoices.com, NicoleSandler.com, or NicoleSandlerStream.com. That's where you can hear it. Audio on YouTube. YouTube is FUBAR today. So there is no video today. And I hope somebody in the chat room, one of the moderators or somebody, can tell new people who come in what's going on, because I can't do it all. Okay. So we got here a year ago. We had an Airbnb that we rented for 2 weeks or so. And knowing that our stuff was on its way from Florida, and hopefully by the time it got here, we would be in a house. And we did. So we rented a house. That was okay. We liked the neighborhood. The house is all right. But it turns out, I'm going to try to make this short as possible, the landlord was not the best person. We already knew the wife was kind of a jerk, and so we didn't deal with her. We dealt with the husband. But it was not a good relationship. We'll leave it at that. He lied to us about a number of things, and we were looking forward to leaving when the lease ended. So our lease is up on, we've got to be out of here by October 11th. So we were looking diligently for a place, and we found a house. We found a great house. And we went back and forth with it. It was going through the actual owner of the house, who is the landlord. Now, just so you know, in case you haven't tried to rent a house lately, there's a new phenomenon, which is all these rental properties are being bought up by big investment firms and run, managed, if you will, by big property management firms. So I'd say at least, say, 3/4 of all the houses listed for rent come in those categories. And the hoops they have you jump through are ridiculous. And that's putting it nicely. It's impossible. And I'll tell you the truth. You know, David and I are both self-employed. So we don't have W-2 forms to show. We don't have a steady paycheck that's the same every week. You know, we live like millions of Americans do, putting all the pieces together and coming up with enough money to pay the rent or the mortgage and the bills and all that. And we've not had a problem meeting the rent on the house we've been in for the last year. And the house we found was actually going to be $5 a month more than we are currently paying. And it was a much nicer house. It was a beautiful house. We walked in, we fell in love with it. So we were supposed to sign that lease 1 week ago today, last Monday. Well, we had gone back and forth on the lease. You know, David negotiated contracts. This has been his business for 44 years. He negotiated contracts for Major League Baseball players. So he knows how to do that. And we went back and forth on every aspect of the lease. and we were all good. The woman who we're renting from is a CPA, so she's very numbers oriented, and she actually, she wrote it all out like in a spreadsheet on how much was due each month for the duration of the lease term. So, you know, we went through everything. We were all in agreement on everything, and it was all good. So last weekend, you may recall, I said I was doing a, and no pay stubs either, that's right. And so you may recall I was doing an art show, right, a craft show. And I had a bunch of stuff at this event, and it ran Saturday and Sunday. So I was there all day Saturday, sold a few things, not as many as I would like, but, you know, it is what it is. And I get home Saturday night, and I'm just getting ready to go to bed. And I realize that, you know, so the thing was to end on Sunday at 4 o'clock. And I borrowed a friend's van to move everything over there. So I said, you know, it's stupid to bring it all back here, unload it, only to have to move it again to the new house the next day, because Monday we were supposed to sign the lease, get the keys, and we could start moving stuff in. Plus, I had borrowed a friend's van and I needed to get it back to her because I had it all weekend. So it just gets better and better. So I text her. Her name is Paula. And actually, that's her American name. She's a Chinese woman. And her first name is actually Yi, Y-E, but I guess the name she goes by here is Paula. And so I said, well, I'll text Paul and see if we can just unload it in the garage. All right. And by the way, I've got pages and pages and pages of texts going back and forth about the house. So let me just share with you from the 18th on. Okay. So the 18th was, what day was the 18th? The 18th was Wednesday of last week. And Paula texts me, I'm working on the hidden area these days to check and clean up the house cleaning lady left to me. Also working on small bathroom, new painting, trying our best to maintain the house and leave good condition to you. And I said, you're awesome. We truly appreciate all you're doing. We can't wait to make this house our home. And she wrote back, great. Last tenant stayed for 3 years. This is the time to do maintenance. Our timing matched perfect. And then she said, once you move in, if you find anything, always feel free to let me know. And I said, thank you. We will. And I so appreciate your wonderful attitude, complete opposite of the owners of the house we've been in for the past year. It gets better. You're not going to believe what happened here. She writes back, you and David should not feel too obligated to the lease. If you have any changes, you need to move out before the lease ends, feel free to give me 45 days notice and I will prorate for you. The most important thing for me is to make sure my tenants happily stay at my house. And I agreed. I wrote back, you're wonderful. I don't anticipate that ever being necessary, but it's good to know that in case of some tragic emergency, the only reason such action might be necessary. And she replied, agree. Today, roof was inspected. One cracked tile was replaced. Dryer vent cleaned. My painting still going on. Looks much better. And then, so they were ordering a refrigerator. The next day, she writes to me, I totally understand, but I just want you to know that I'm seeing that your lovely refrigerator is scheduled to arrive to you by the 24th of September. Just followed up with the supplier. Please see their response above. If you want, they said it should arrive by the 24th. If you want to start the lease later, we can do that. I said, no problem at all. No problem at all. And so then we went back and forth on the payments and everything. And so then I said, who should I have the care? This is on the 20th. Okay. The 20th was Friday. Again, we were supposed to meet with her at the house on Monday to give her the money, get the keys, and we can start moving in. So I asked, who should I have the cashier's check made out to? I'll get that done first thing Monday morning. And she gave me her Chinese name, the American spelling, the English spelling of her Chinese name. And I said, and I'll get all the utilities switched over Monday morning too. And she said, okay, thanks. We have 48 hours to test on the fridge. And so we were all talking about power and water and gas. And then she says, wish you have a wonderful art show tomorrow. And I said, thank you. Then she wrote, Gardner postponed the work to next Friday, 9/27. I said, okay. So on September 21st, now this is Saturday night, right? I wrote, Paula, I have a favor to ask. The art show ends tomorrow afternoon. I'm using a friend's van. Would it be possible to drop my stuff in the garage so I won't have to unpack it here just to move it again? It would save me a lot of time and work. The show ends at 4, so I'm thinking I could be there around 5:30. And she said, I will be at the house around 5:30 tomorrow, and you can store your artwork at the garage. And I wrote, thank you so much. And then she said, you can wait to turn on the gas for a few days before you move in. Don't turn it on too early. And I said, okay. And then she said, once you know City of Chandler transfer date, let me know. Again, that's for the water service. I said, and then she said, see you tomorrow. And I said, will do. Thank you. And then she sent another text with the total amount that I needed to give her in a cashier's check. And then she said, if you want to move artwork tomorrow, we need to change the lease start date to be tomorrow. And I'll give the key to you tomorrow. I do not want to take any risk on your personal belongings. You can simply leave your artwork in your car and move to my house on Monday after we sign the lease. See you Monday. That's the next. So she, in two different texts, she totally changed her tune. And I responded, it's not in my car. I'm borrowing a friend's van, and I need to return it to her tomorrow evening. I'm happy to have the lease start tomorrow. I'd be able to use Zelle to send you the money as it's on my regular checking account, but I don't have that much in my PayPal account. And she said, we can go to ATM or bank to take cash because Zelle has a limit on the daily transactions. And I wrote back, well, so does an ATM. And she said, it is better to return the van to your friends on Monday. I feel abide by our schedule will be easy for everyone. And then I said, well, I can sign a waiver saying you're not responsible for my belongings. Then I'll just have to move everything twice, is what I said. And her response to that was, since your lease will end on October 10th, you still have lots of time to find a better house with a pool. So David, do not need to spend more. And I can return your PayPal now. There are so many issues. So by now, my heart was like, what? And I said, we want to rent your house. We'll close the deal Monday. And she wrote back, more and more houses come to market with reduced price. Tell you the truth. I feel so bad my house does not have pool and David have to spend extra $100 on pool. Okay, this is me now. So David runs in the pool. He works out. He takes care of himself. The house didn't have a pool. It's okay. We already, look, he'll do without the pool. We made that decision. But this is the excuse she's using now to back out, right? I said, don't worry about the pool. I'll deal with my art stuff. We love your house and we're planning to move in. We don't want to look for something else. Her response, at current market situation, I'm sure your current landlord will not increase the rent for you. I can talk to them. To which I said, we don't want to stay here. We are leaving and want to rent your house. We'll sign everything on Monday. And she said, my suggestion is you look for other houses because my house does not have pool. So hard to satisfy David's need. What? And I said, we don't want to look for other houses. We are making plans to move starting Tuesday. And she says, in order to reduce future issues, I decided to return your $500. Earnest money deposit that we put down. And I said, why? I don't understand. What issues? Please don't do this. And she says, I will return your money now. I found more better houses for you. You should protect yourself. And I do not want to force you to rent my house. I said, you're not forcing us to do anything. Please don't do this. Please at least talk to me first. And these are all, each line is another text message. I don't want the money back. I want to rent your house. And then I tried calling you and it went right to voicemail. Please, in all caps, don't do this. And I'm like, why did you do this? What happened? We love your house and I thought we had a great relationship with you. And she responded, my suggestion is you still have extra time to look for houses. Try to find other house. I feel so bad that my house does not have pool and Dave has to drive to other places. Do you hear what's going on? And no, and someone in the chat room said she sounds like a Trump voter. She's not. She said she loves our values. I mean, I could go back and read and recount some of our conversations. She loved us. She loved Jackson. She loves our values. We raised Jackson, so he's such a good boy. It shows how you raise him with your values. So I answer again. I said, we don't need the pool. Please don't do this to us. We looked at many houses, and believe me, we did. Yours is the one we fell in love with. I don't understand why you're doing this. And she answers, trust on me. More and more houses come up and rent will continue to decrease. I just feel so bad that my house does not have pool and your family have to spend more. I will feel bad to let you increase financial burden. I'm in the good heart to think of you. Your will find a better house, better fit house with pool. And again, at this point, again, this is late Saturday night. I'm supposed to go back to the art show on Sunday and sign the lease on Monday and start moving in. So I answer her again. I said, it's nothing for you to feel bad about, and it's not increasing our burden. It's $5 more a month. And then I said, we don't want a different house. Why are you doing this? If you cared, you wouldn't be hurting me this way. And then I said, we're supposed to sign the lease in 2 days. Now you're backing out? Is there another reason? I'm in tears now. I cannot believe you're doing this. And her response is, David's reaction to me makes feel this is not the house he wants. I have to remind you to connect utilities. No, she didn't. This makes me feel I'm pushing you rent on my house. I just want to be fair to you. At current market, I'm sure you can find better house. I'm like, you didn't have to remind me of anything. I'm taking care of everything on my end. It seems that you just don't want us there. I'm telling you, we want that house. But you're telling me you know better? I cannot believe you agreed to lease to us and now you're backing out. And she responded, right? And she responded, this is renter market now. I'm sure you will find a house with pool with lower than current rent. All the best wishes to you. And then she said, I feel bad to see David feel he rent my house. He needs to spend extra. I have to sleep now. Need to wake up early for kids' activities. All the best wishes to you. By now, it's like 10:30 Saturday night. I'm shaking. I'm in tears. I'm freaking out. And I said, if you're worried about feeling bad about something, this is the worst thing you could do to us. And I said, I'm begging you, please don't back out of our agreement. Begging you. And she, and then the next, or 2 days, next day, she says, as I mentioned to you in the email, my family will move in. Please look for other houses in the market. Thanks. Well, apparently she emailed an attachment to an account with some bullshit reasons that at this point I hadn't even seen it. I said, you did not mention that to me. You just decided to renege on our agreement at the last minute, causing us undue stress and hardship. I cannot believe you did this to us. You will have a lawsuit on your hands. I can't believe you did this to us. You pretended to be my friend, then stabbed me in the back. And she said, I emailed to you. And I said, no, you didn't. You just pulled out of our contract in the middle of a text conversation. Now you're lying about it. And she wrote back, see you at court. So needless to say, you know me, I'm tough to a certain point and then I lose it. And, you know, I just wrote back, WTF is wrong with you. I have all the evidence I need in writing. You've caused a mountain of stress and difficulty by doing this. We had a contract that you reneged on. Would you rather be served at home or at work? And I ranted on her for a while and I didn't hear back. So that was the, hold on. Jonathan is, doing, I'm going to say, we'll do this by phone. Having YouTube issues, call 954-889-6410. Hold on. Let me send this to Jonathan so he comes in. Yes, David. Oh, you know, so you want to add? So we're audio only today because of my,
that's,
you know,
fine.
Everything.
They weren't going to see my lovely face anyway.
Right.
First of all, you're much too kind to the current landlord. His wife is a rancid cunt.
Okay, David. Okay.
That's number one.
The current landlords are horrible, and so we have to get out of here.
He is a liar.
I know. We're not doing this now, please.
Okay. And Paula proved herself to tell lie after lie after lie. And that being said, I was the one who suggested to you, so it's my fault. I said, why don't you, you know, contact Paula and ask if you can just move the stuff into her garage.
Right. Well, because it made sense.
Right. And then she lost her fucking mind. She's mentally fucking ill.
Well, she is. The last thing I texted to her is, you're mentally ill and you need help. So anyway, so that happened. I wake up Sunday morning to go to... I wake up Sunday morning to go to the art show. I'm supposed to be there at, you know, the doors open at 9 o'clock. I wake up Well, I didn't sleep much. And I woke up at probably 5:30 having a panic attack. And, you know, I couldn't leave the house. I mean, I finally got there. I got to the show. I made myself go. I got there probably about 9:30. And the first thing I did was I called David. And I said, please call Max and see if he will come and you guys come and help me load this up because I can't be here today. So we had to start finding another house. I mean, we were ready to move. We had a landlord threatening. I mean, the landlord here is really bad. And they were threatening to evict us. Not that they can. And we're going to be out in by October 10th anyway. And I'll tell you all about that another time. And nothing we did, just so you know. Negligence on his part. My mic just became super loud. Okay, let me turn it down because I just turned off something. Anyway, so I wound up losing the second day at the art show. The house we rented is about $100 a month more than we were going to pay her. Not as big. Very nice, but I love the house we're renting now. But anyway, so all day Monday, all day Tuesday, all day Wednesday, all day Thursday. This is why I wasn't on the air. We were looking at houses. And we found one that we liked. But again, and the people seemed willing to work with us. But I was, you know, once bitten, twice shy. I was gun shy. I was afraid this was going to happen again. So there were two more houses we went to see on Saturday morning. We were supposed to meet the other people, the new people, at their house. Again, because I can't rent from one of those big companies. I always look for the owners and deal directly with the owners. So we were supposed to meet the owners, who live in California, by the way, at their house on Sunday. We went to see this place on Saturday. Yeah. Or maybe it was Friday. Friday after taping with Marcy Wheeler, we went to see this house. It was Friday afternoon and we saw two houses and one of them we really, really liked. And, but we were supposed to meet these other people at their house on Sunday. Well, we went back and forth all day Saturday with this new house we saw. And they were willing to work with us. And it must have been 9:30, 9:45, finally Saturday night, that we were going back and forth. And we hammered out a lease agreement. We met her at the house yesterday. Once we got everything settled, I spoke to the other people who were very nice. And I hope my fear was I was doing to them exactly what Paula did to us. But she didn't take it that way. And she was very fine with it. They had another couple who wanted the house. So at least I knew I wasn't leaving them in the lurch. They had somebody else who her friend, it's so complicated. Her friend who is in the Phoenix area, showed us the house and showed these other people the house as well. And the friend told the other people she was going to make sure they got it. What is wrong with people? You know, I don't understand. So, this woman, her name, Rena, she said, after we first agreed that, okay, we'll meet you at the house on Sunday and they would rent to us. She said, now, how do I tell these other people that Mary told would have the house that they're not getting it? And I'm like, oh no. Oh, please. I my stomach is all in knots. I was on this roller coaster for a week and that made me feel bad. And then we found this other house and I'm like, okay, there's nobody else in the picture. They had just listed it. We were the only people looking at it. So when I called Rena and told her, she was perfectly fine with it. She said, I'm glad you found something you love that's going to work for you. I wish you the best of luck. So there's that. We spent all day, again, Saturday night till about 9:45, we finally electronically signed the lease. We met her at the house yesterday. She gave us the keys. We gave her the balance of the money that we had to put down. And we brought over the first couple of loads of stuff. But I had to explain to you why I was off the air all week. Because it was so... it was just horrible. And that people have to go through shit like this to find a place to live, to not feel like you're going to be out on the street. I'm sorry, I'm crying now. The audio is bad again? No. Okay, so anyway, I'm better now, but I felt like I had to share all that with you so you knew what was going on. We now have a house. It is still in Chandler. This other house, well, it doesn't matter. It's still in Chandler. It's about 6 miles from where we are now. We love it. I have a real studio there because there's this room that has its own a separate, you know, external entrance. So if I ever want to have a guest, you know, on the show, they don't have to go through the house because I'm a pack rat. Anyway, so it's been a fucking roller coaster that, you know, we're finally on the upswing again. But I feel like since June, I'm telling you, since I got COVID, it's been one thing after another, after another, after another. So, there's that. So we have a place. We will be moving. We do have until the 10th to get out of here. So I hope not to be off the air for another day. What I plan on is after recording with Marcy on Friday, deep breaths, I'll pack up my studio. And I'll move the studio over the weekend, and I should be good to go from the new place next Monday. All right. With all that, Jonathan Larsen, are you there?
How can you possibly expect me to come in after that?
Well, you know, now you know why I was off the air all last week. This had just happened, you know, not even a day and a half before we were supposed to go on Monday. I was having panic attacks. I'm like, oh my God, where are we going to live? Because it's not easy when you are self-employed to go out and try to rent a house. Because I'll tell you something, you know, I adopted my daughter. And when I did that, the paperwork was just insurmountable. They asked for every aspect of your life. This was almost that bad. The stuff they demand of you, and actually the second woman, Rena, the one who we didn't take their house, she called me. She's like, you know, you sent me all this stuff and I really appreciate it. She goes, I feel horrible, like prying through your personal things, but it's really intrusive. And so, we had to do that 3 times. So, but we have the house, we have the keys, we love the house. I was going to show a picture of Jackson with the new owner's 4-year-old little girl who loved each other, and all will be well. But, you know, I got to pack up this place and move. But, hey, at least, you know, we have the keys, so they can't do this to me again.
Well, it's the mark of quite a pro that I heard you go in 1 second from crying, we were homeless, we had no place to live to. Wait, there's a problem with the audio?
Yeah. Well, that's, you know, because I do it all myself. I don't have a producer. I don't have staff.
And I know, but YouTube, it's like it took such precedence over these intense personal emotions.
Well,
you're in the middle of sobbing in the air, and then it's like, wait a minute, audio issues.
I'm a multitasker.
Exactly.
So anyway, Friday morning, we still didn't know what was going on. And I'm like, I got to have Marcy Wheeler on because, you know, first of all, I was so out of the loop. I didn't know what happened last week. If I was not out looking at houses, I was on the computer looking for listings for rentals that were coming on the market. I mean, it was that stressful of a week. So I got Marcy. Yeah. We did all the recording. I wrapped it all up. I set the video for an automatic premiere at Showtime. I sent the audio to Progressive Voices, so they ran it. And the minute I got done with everything, we went out again looking at houses. And that's when we saw this house. But, you know, I was really nervous. It's like, I'm thinking we're going to have to put all of our shit in storage and move in with our son, with David's, you know, David's son, my bonus son, until we find a place. And, you know, it's moving is one of the biggest stressors in life. But having all this other shit on top of moving, oh, my God.
Yeah.
So, anyway, that's where I am. So I plan on, we'll see if I can pull this off, not missing another day until, well, the week of the election. I'm taking some time off, believe it or not, because my kid's coming in for my birthday. But until then, I hope to be on the air every day and moving around that. So anyway, hi, Jonathan Larsen. Oh, you know what? I should just do this.
It's time for the fucking news from NicoleSandler.com.
And Jonathan Larsen at thefuckingnews.substack.com.
He said a very bad word.
Oh, the language on you.
You're a fucking newsman.
The fucking
news.
So that's why when I texted you this morning, I'm like, so did anything happen this week? Because I really had no idea. Yeah.
It's very impressive that you, given all this, you still have your board with all your cues.
Oh, well, yeah, this is my setup. So now I have to tear this apart on Friday and rebuild it over there. And I do it all myself. I'm hoping that on Monday, it's working well, because I only have, let's see, you'll be impressed with this booking I have. On, I think it's Wednesday of next week. Wednesday, the 9th of October, I have Christopher Steele coming on the show.
Wow.
The dossier guy. Yeah, his book is called...
His book is The
other dossier guy. His book is called Unredacted. And I have him live at 2 o'clock at the top of the show, 5 Eastern, on Wednesday the 9th. So the studio has to be up and running by then.
Yeah.
You will
give birth to 1,000 conspiracy theories if you promote that, and then you're not on the air.
Yeah. And so while we're promoting, tomorrow, I don't know what we have tomorrow, but tomorrow night is the VP debate. So that'll be fun.
Yeah.
And on Wednesday, Tom Hartman will be here. Tom Hartman's got another book out. He writes books, one a month or something. He's like very prolific. So Tom Hartman will be here Wednesday. I'm gonna tear down the studio and rebuild it at the new house this weekend. So that's
a book's always a great opportunity to get a name in the studio.
Oh yeah. Well, it'll be on Zoom, but. So it is. But once I get in the new house.
I meant metaphor.
Right. Yes. Yeah, I gotcha. So anyway, that's the only reason I have Christopher Steele. There's no way he'd come on this show otherwise. And, I'm feeling good. If I do pat myself on the back, I do a pretty damn good interview. And the publisher of his book, Unredacted, is HarperCollins, and they actually pitched me. And the book will be out.
Nice.
The book is released on Tuesday, and I have him on Wednesday. So
that's great.
Yeah. So
hopefully he'll push it beforehand, too.
Probably not. I'm sure he'll be making the rounds. I mean, you'll see him everywhere.
Right, but on his social media or whatever.
That would be nice. That would be nice. So anyway, mark all the wires. Oh, thank you. Honey Bunny is telling me to mark all the wires and take pictures before I start pulling plugs. I have moved this studio so many times, but I appreciate the advice, of course. No, I have things marked pretty well, but there's always something always goes wrong. But the studio, the room that will be my studio, is it's got built-in cabinets. It should be really nice. So I'm very excited
about it.
And I even have my own bathroom in my studio. So we got that going for us.
Well, if you decide to go the OnlyFans route, you're all set.
That's right. Look, hey, it's so much potential. So anyway, Jonathan Larsen, we did talk about a little bit what went on this week. And one of the things was...
You keep saying what happened this week, and it's Monday. Today's Monday.
No, last week. I mean, this past week. But the storm, oh my God, and here's another thing. So, I moved here from Florida. My daughter is still there. This storm, had we been in Florida, would not have affected us because we were in the southeast Florida. The Miami-Fort Lauderdale area was spared. They maybe got a little bit of rain, if that, from the outer bands. This came up the Gulf, and it hit Tampa Bay really hard. So St. Petersburg, St. Pete, Clearwater, even all the way down to Naples apparently got it really bad. But the worst part, I'm seeing a lot of stuff from Asheville, North Carolina, which is in the mountains of North Carolina, which you wouldn't think would be worried about a hurricane, but something called climate change. Anyway, I notice that this woman who... there's a whole community of us on Facebook. And the main reason I'm still on Facebook is because I'm old friends. That's the only way I keep in touch with them. And Mary Dew... Maridew, if anyone's interested in following what's going on with her on Facebook, lives in Asheville with her two dogs, and no one has heard from her since Friday night. I met her.
I mean, she might just not have power.
Right, and that's what we're hoping. I mean, hopefully she's up on the second floor. They have no phone service. They have no power. They have no cell service, and hopefully she and her dogs are safe. But her family, nobody's heard from her since Friday. And But I know her. I knew her from, she was a record promotion person when I was the music director of a radio station in LA. And so that's how I know her. I have a picture of the two of us with Gary Louris from the band, the Jayhawks, posted up there. But it's a small kind of tight-knit community, radio and the record industry, yeah, who all worked together back in the 90s and 2000s. And so that's how I'm keeping up with this. And I'm just, this is like the one of the nicest people you'll ever meet. And I keep checking, and there was a rumor posted that, oh no, she was evacuated. She went to Nashville. And then someone else said, that's not, her family has not confirmed that. And, you know, please take this down. So there's a lot of misinformation going around and people are freaking, and I just hope she's okay. But, you know, there are dozens dead already from this storm because it's massive.
Just in the state.
Yeah. So Florida got it. Georgia got it. North Carolina got hit really, really hard. And, you know, shit like this is just going to keep happening. And, you know, let me also say that, oh, it's cooled down here a bit. It's 104 degrees on September 30th. Past week, you know, I know John Fugelsang, who's an old friend of mine, was in town for a show Saturday night. It was Stephanie Miller's Sexy Liberal thing, which thankfully I didn't go to because we were negotiating this lease all night until 10 o'clock, you know, Saturday night. But I told John I wasn't going to make it. And but he posted something, you know, showing a screenshot from his phone that it said it was 114 degrees. And he's like, wow, welcome to Phoenix. And it feels like 115. It was, and this is hotter. It's not usually this hot right now. So.
Right. Yeah. Yeah. I mean, it's a day from October.
Yeah. Yeah. Tomorrow's October 1st. And again,
yeah, I think, yeah, I was just going to say, I think in the Tampa, St. Pete area, my sense, both in sort of reading between the lines, but also talking to my friend down there, is I don't think they've ever seen flooding like this.
No.
It hit areas that it's never hit before. It reached heights it's never hit before. And you know how much rain they got?
How much?
1 inch.
Seriously?
It was storm surge.
Storm surge.
It was storm surge.
Up in Asheville? I mean, that's what's weird.
No.
Oh, in Florida, in Tampa. Gotcha. No, and you see, it looks like sand dunes on the roads because all the sand from the Gulf came up onto the streets. Yeah.
Of course. Yeah.
It's crazy.
Yeah, I mean, it must be thousands of cars ruined.
Oh, yes.
It must be, you know, thousands of homes that are going to need thousands of dollars for a renovation.
Millions and millions of billions, probably.
The amount the insurance companies are going to have to pay out is going to be astronomical.
Yep.
And then they're going to be done with that place.
And they already are. Well, that's, you know, the insurance has been a crisis in Florida for years now. And when Santos came in, or DeSantis, sorry, Governor Death Sentence came in, The biggest issue facing Florida then was the homeowner's insurance because you couldn't get it.
Right.
And he did nothing. Rick Scott did nothing for all the years for the eight years he was in office. And hopefully he'll be, you know, beaten out of the Senate next month. But
that's a close race.
I know it is now. And Debbie Mercosell Powell is nothing. And if she's going to beat him, that's a big deal. But the thing is, this crisis has been going on. DeSantis gets into office and he calls a special session to deal with homeowners insurance. No, to deal with the Don't Say Gay bill. To his social bullshit issues. So
it's not the rising floodwaters.
Right.
It's the drag queens that are
of course, don't you know? Yeah. Right. Insane. Just the world is insane. But so you couldn't get homeowners insurance in Florida before this. And it's only going to be worse now. But, you know, and again, I'm looking at the mountains of North Carolina got devastated by a hurricane.
Yeah.
I mean, it's scary. Scary times.
Was that entirely rain or was it that there was something upstream from them that they were getting a lot from that, or what exactly was it?
You're asking the wrong person because
I
didn't see the news at all. I just know what I've read on.
Right.
I don't know. I really don't know.
Yeah.
But I feel horrible. And again, I keep checking Facebook to see if there's any news on Mary. I'm just, I hope she's okay. Because she's like one of the, you know, the record industry, there are some sleazy, skeezy people there. She was one of the really nice ones. I think these days she teaches yoga or something in Asheville, North Carolina, which is a very blue area, by the way.
I know.
You know, I knew her in L.A. So it's now 20, 30 years later. And we're all scattered. But that's why I stay on Facebook, to keep in touch with a lot of these people. And yeah, well,
Washington,
it's horrible.
Washington Post had a piece on an entire town
yes.
that's virtually gone.
I saw it. It's horrible.
Is there any way to like try the local cops?
Oh, there's a list. They have a list of people who were missing. And once they're found, their name is crossed off and she's still listed as missing. There, the authorities are on it.
Does that mean they've gone to her house?
I don't know.
And they've looked for her?
I do not know.
Oh,
I really don't
scary.
Know.
I didn't realize there was an official
list.
Yeah,
there's an official list, and she's on the missing list. So
how old is she?
She's probably, I'm thinking she's younger than I am. So she, Mary's got probably about 50 now. I mean, because we worked together 30 years ago. So, yeah.
But it's not like she's infirm or anything like
that.
Oh,
God, no. No, she's young and healthy.
Well,
and,
that's a good
In fact, I'm going to pull up her page now because it's been an hour. Okay. This is from 2 hours ago. This is the post that was shared with me. Okay. Somebody posted, she is safe. According to a Facebook message board, she was evacuated to Nashville to a friend's house with her dogs. The reposting works. But now I see someone who's in Nashville with a 615 area code number posted here and says, thank you. Prayers to literally light her up with all our love. La, 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 la. Please keep us posted. My direct line is please text. Calls don't always come through. So yeah, people are still saying until we hear directly from Mary that she is safe, please stop posting that she was found and flown to Nashville with her dogs. This misinformation is not helpful. So that's what's going on her Facebook page right now.
True. It actually could be.
Right, but tell, you know, don't say it unless you know personally firsthand for sure, because now it's going back and forth. And like someone just said, we have not heard from her. I would think Mary would post herself, and she's still showing up on this list as missing. But I'll tell you, the list has a lot of red lines, a lot of missings, and there's, you know, 1, 2, 3, 4, 5, 6, 7, 8, 9, 10, 11 found and probably 30 still missing on this short list. Numbers 209 to 246, 11 of them are found and the rest are still listed as missing. And this is, I guess, just in the Asheville area. I'm just seeing a little bit of a spreadsheet. So it's frightening. This is terrifying.
Yeah. Yeah.
Yeah. And Donald Trump went to Georgia to throw paper towels into the crowd or something?
Yeah. I said in this morning's Fox News, I said, please pray to Jesus that we get another paper towel throwing.
Yeah. Wow. It's just all incredible. Just amazing.
And I love the fact that on Friday he said, if we were there, we'd be helping.
Yeah.
Which is another
way
of saying, I'm not there, so I'm not helping.
You know, he seems to be getting more and more unhinged. I mean, I've got audio and the video's not playing my, you know, best laid plans. I mean, of course, I should. And believe me, this computer restarted like 3 times today because I have something called a UPS. And it's not brown. It's uninterruptible power source. So it's like a big backup battery, like a surge protector. Yeah. And supposedly, if there is a power surge or the power goes out for a couple of minutes, it'll keep me on the air. It crapped out 3 times today. And so I'm going, oh, shit, maybe my UPS battery is dying because I've had it for a few years. I don't know how these things work. So I had to unplug everything and plug it back in. I used 2 different computers for the show, and both of them restarted numerous times because of that. And of course, the minute I go on the air, it's all fucked up again. So yeah, this has been my luck. I'm telling you, since I got COVID in June, it's been one thing after another. So I think I'm about due to win the lottery.
Yeah, hopefully it's a lot of zeros.
Yeah, no shit. I'm not counting on it either, though. So you know, this is a good time to thank, and I left the my notes in the other room. But a few of my listeners, first of all, are awesome. Jonathan, I don't know if you've met any of them who've come over to thefuckingnews.substack.com or jonathanlarsen.substack.com yet. I know a number of them have subscribed, but, you know, the last time I was sick, my pesky UTI E. coli infection, I had two trips to the emergency room. And because the insurance that you can get the year before you're Medicare eligible is so expensive and so shitty, you know, I told David that the only insurance I could get when we moved here was bad. And I said, do not let me get sick this year. Wrap me in bubble wrap if you must. I cannot get sick this year. And of course, I haven't been sick in 4 years because since before COVID, because we weren't leaving the house. And I get COVID and then I get this. I had two ER trips. My copay for an emergency room visit is $2,200.
Whoa.
Yeah. So that's $4,500, $4,400 that went right on my credit card. And that's not any of the other shit they hit you with. That's just my copay. So another reason that I've been stressed, right? So, you know, Medicare kicks in for me a month from tomorrow because my birthday is November 4th. It kicks in November 1st. But, you know, I keep saying I'm going to do a fundraiser to help with the medical bills. You know, in my spare time, when I have a minute to turn around, which now is not going to be until after we move, but a few of my listeners, and one who is this woman, Carla, I love you. She came through big time. I went to my PO box yesterday, and there were three envelopes there, and you guys are great. The other one, there was another really very, very generous donation from somebody who said she's been listening on and off for 14 years. And she wanted to help out with my medical bills. And her name is written down in the other room, and I don't have it here, but I will thank her tomorrow. And Peter also, his check came in. You know, you guys, I don't ask for money much because I don't like to, but it really helps. And especially when the medical bills pile up, and thankfully I have one more month. I'm telling you, I am going to go. I've got lots of bubble wrap here. I think I'm just going to wrap myself in it so that nothing else can happen.
And once you get that paid off, you got to do a fundraiser for a pool. I'm told a pool is essential.
Well, now see, David runs in the pool. So my husband, you know, we're getting old. I'm going to be 65, but he's 72. It's like, how the fuck does that happen? 72? But he's in great shape because he works out. He takes care of himself. And he, for years, he used to run, but he had a lot of, you know, he had football injuries and stuff when he was younger. So he has it's called the Aqua Jogger. And it's a belt that goes around your waist. It's a buoyancy belt. Okay. And he runs in the pool. And this, you know, this house actually has a pool. But, you know, you can use it for maybe 4 or 5 months out of the year. But most of the houses we looked at that had a pool, there's a new thing where they're a maximum of 5 feet deep. Because they're afraid people are going to dive in and break their necks. Well, I would think the shallower the pool is, the bigger the chance that someone's going to get hurt. But what do I know? We saw like three houses that were possibles. And in fact, one of the houses that we were supposed to rent or that had a pool, but it was only 5 feet, not deep enough for him to run in. So he would have had to go out and find a pool anyway. So we took, you know, pool off the list of what we needed.
Right.
So, you know, I'm hoping there's a community pool or something around there, that he can, you know, run at or a YMCA or something. That was the thing about the pool. And we'd already decided, all right, we're taking the pool off the list because we're asking for an impossibility and, you know, we don't have unlimited funds to rent a house. So, you know, if we wanted to pay another $1,000 a month, it wouldn't have been an issue, I'm sure. But, you know, we're on a budget. So all that happened. Oh, man.
I didn't even hear the entire story with that non-landlord, but wow.
Yeah. Oh,
my God. That was crazy.
That she backed out on, and it was so, what was so weird was we're having this text conversation, and when I first asked her, she said, okay, I'll see you at 5:30 tomorrow, no problem. And then it's like, well, no, then we have to sign the lease early. And then it's like, you know what? There's too many issues here. Never mind. I'm sending you your money back. I'm like, what?
It occur to me that there is a bright side to this.
Yeah.
If you don't mind me trying to rosy it up.
Please.
If someone's that much of a mess in this process, it could very well be that living there would have been a real nightmare.
Without a doubt. We dodged a bullet because the woman is nuts. She's nuts. And after our experience with the landlords we have now, that's the last thing we wanted. So, you know, these people seem nice enough. The ones we're renting from now, we got the keys yesterday. They live in northern Phoenix, so they're not right around the corner, but they're close enough if there's an issue. They seem normal people. They seem nice enough. Yeah, Progressive Voices is going to cut off the show soon. I will podcast the whole thing, so it'll be audio, and I'll cut off all the audio problems at the beginning so it won't be too messy. Yeah, but I'm going to lose everyone who's listening on Progressive Voices. You can still listen at NicoleSandlerStream.com, and yeah, we're still streaming there. But yeah, so this is why I'm so like schizophrenic. I'm like three different things going on in my head at once. Okay, the show and posting the podcast.
Sounds
and the
like
move
a lot
and
more
the,
than three.
Oh, a lot more than three. But yeah, so I was not in good shape this past week. So I'm now that we got into the house. We went to dinner with Max and Christine, our son, and his soon-to-be wife, I hope, last night. And we went over and showed them the house. And it's like, okay, so we're on our way back. So
that's great.
Yeah. Ah! And now I need a vacation. So I'll warn everybody now. So my daughter is coming in for my birthday. She was going to surprise me. But when I was sick, she thought this would make you feel better now. So she is coming in late at night on the 31st. And so Friday
is Halloween.
She's flying in from Florida. She gets in late at night. So on Friday, the 1st, I'm going to have to tape with Marcy on Thursday that week. So I can have a Friday show that week to run. But Friday, the 1st, we're picking up a mini RV. That comfortably sleeps four, allegedly, but comfortably sleeps two. And Allison and Jackson, my dog, and I are taking a little three-night road trip. We're going to go up to Sedona and Flagstaff and, you know, little quickie Arizona, you know, Thelma and Louise trip without the dying. And, yeah. And so I'll be off the air Friday, and then she leaves on the 5th. So I'll be off on, well, Friday, hopefully I'll have a pre-taped show with Marcy. I'll be off on my birthday, which is Monday the 4th. So Jonathan, you will be off that day.
And Monday the 4th of November.
November, that's my birthday. And election day is the 5th. So we will not have a live show that day because we'll be RVing. And she leaves at like 1 o'clock in the morning on the 5th. So I'll be back on the air that day on election day. Ah! Yeah. If I'm still standing by then.
Well, it sounds like you've come through the worst of it.
Yeah, no, it definitely.
You know, the move, but the move is just a pain in the ass. It's not
exactly
crazy making and gaslighting.
Right. After last week, oh my God. Plus, I kind of want to sue this woman. I'm not litigious, but, you know, first of all, I lost one day of this art show that I was supposed to do. So I lost money on that deal. I was off the air for a week. The anxiety alone, I mean, I was a mess. And you know, my listeners who've been with me long enough, have been through enough with me. I've suffered from depression most of my life, and I've moments. And I had a really, really hard time when Donald Trump became president. I somehow stayed on the air, but it was not easy going. You know, I've always been honest. I mental health issues, and this really fucked me up. So I want to sue her ass because she deserves it. So we'll see. And I could.
You do what you want to do.
Yep.
I tend to think that
karma will get her.
I always worry that I feel like suing takes a psychic toll on the person
doing
the suing.
Yeah, but she deserves it. Hold on, David's here.
What do you mean you kind of want to sue
her? Yeah.
We are definitely suing that fucking bitch.
Okay, thank you. That's David. So we're definitely suing that bitch. No, she,
okay.
Because
in that case,
she inflicted, I mean, you, I don't know how much you heard of the text exchange, but she's total breach of contract. She took our earnest money. She, you know, it was so cut and dry. This is a done deal. And then in the course of a 30-minute long text conversation back and forth, she went from, I'll see you tomorrow at 5:30. Sure, you can leave your stuff in the garage, to here's your deposit back. Have a good life. Like, what?
Yeah.
Yeah. So, no. And he had to put up with me for a week. And believe me, me having a panic attack is not a nice thing to be around. It's kind of scary. So,
well, I'm sorry you went through all that. That sounds
Yep.
Yeah.
Yeah. Right. Yeah. Honey asked in the chat room, did you get your $500 back? Yeah. But I didn't want it back. You know, she's like, this is, you don't want this house. So here, I feel bad. Like, what do you mean you feel bad? If you want to feel bad, this is what you should feel bad about. My God. Anyway, this has been a very self-indulgent show. So thanks for appearing with me.
It is your show.
It is my show. Yes. Yes.
Wait, hold on. She put the house back on the market for more money than we had agreed to pay.
That, well, she did do
that. I figured that's what it was about.
Yep. So she did. She put the house back on the market like 3 days later. So first few days it wasn't yet on. And then I'm still looking for houses. And then I'm like, oh my God. Detroit is back on the market. It's on Detroit Street. So, if anyone wants to check it out, there's a house on Detroit Street in Chandler, Arizona that's for rent. And it's listed by Paula, who is the owner. Someone could have some fun with her. That's all I'll say. It's on Zillow.
That's really probably more than you should say.
Probably. But, you know, she's looking to rent it now. So... maybe some prospective renters should contact her.
You're helping her advertise.
That's right. There's a great house. It's a beautiful 4-bedroom, I think it's 3-bath house in Chandler, Arizona on Detroit Street. No pool in that one.
Make sure everyone knows it has a pool.
It doesn't have a pool. That one did not have a pool.
I know, but tell everyone it has a pool.
Oh, my God. All right. Jonathan, I will let you go.
Congratulations.
Thank you.
/condolences.
Thank you. And hopefully next Monday, knocking on wood laminate here, when we talk, you'll be able to see my new studio.
Very exciting.
Yeah. Yeah.
Mark the wires.
Yes, I will mark the wires. All right. Thanks, Jonathan. Jonathan Larsen, everybody. Now there's two places you could get his work, at thefuckingnews.substack.com and at jonathanlarsen.substack.com. How's that going? Is it taking off?
Well, the new one is really just for like original reporting.
Right,
I don't think I've put up anything since I launched it yet. I'm working on projects. I'm actually at the fucking news. I'm going to be posting a debate preview tonight called The Coach versus the Couch. So if people want to sign up, they'll get that. And then tomorrow we're gonna do the debate live at the fuckingnews.substack.com.
Oh, good.
Yeah, we'll follow on. Yeah.
Cool. So there's a virtual watch party. I was gonna find out about one here, but I haven't had time to turn around, so I did not get that done. To whoever I told online I was gonna look into it, I just didn't get to. So I don't know if there are any watch parties or not.
Sounds like you've got a pretty good alibi established at this point.
I'll be packing and watching at the same time.
Right.
Yep. All right. Jonathan, thank you so much.
Enjoy
Thanks
it.
For bearing with me. I'll Thanks talk to you next week. Thanks. Bye.
Bye.
All right. Jonathan Larsen, everyone, from the fucking news. And to you guys who stuck with me through this, I'm so sorry about the audio problems. I got one more thing to deal with tonight and tomorrow morning before the show. And I'll see if Digby can cut. Digby was supposed to come on with me last week. And first she was going to come on Tuesday. Then she was going to come on Wednesday. And then we said, all right, once once I find a place and I'm back on the air, then she'll come on. So maybe we'll get her tomorrow if she's available. If not, I can do all the stuff that I was going to do today and show you. And I'm not going to talk about this anymore unless, you know, something else happens. But, oh, my God. Welcome to my world. All right. With that, we're done. I will post an audio podcast that will sound better than what it was like on YouTube. And maybe if I get really ambitious, I will put up a logo, put the audio from the podcast up and post that on YouTube because people are going, I can't find your feed all last week. Where are you? So, no, that's not it, Kate. Hold on. I'm going to put, it was like, what was the address? I'll find it. I'll put it in the chat room. I won't close the chat room until I find the house number. It was an amazing house. Hold on. I you know what? We're in overtime now anyway. I'm going to pull it up on Zillow. Because I'm not getting that house. I can give you that address. It was not the one you put in there, though. Hold on. Let's see. It was not that one. Yeah, she's got it listed for $2,850 a month. The number is, I'm putting in the chat room, West Detroit. Okay. There you go. So anyway, with that, we're done. And I will see you tomorrow. And thank you so much for bearing with me. I really appreciate it. Peace out.
4633 West Detroit.
4633 West Detroit Street, Chandler, Arizona. See you tomorrow.